Hi, I'm the Warrior Witch, and you can call me Nike. So we're back in the workroom, because today is going to be more of a work-style thing, or at least like a work-oriented thing. And by that I mean we're going to be talking about tips for studying, but like specifically for witchcraft. So this can be used for school stuff, and so if you want to use them for school, absolutely go for it. I use some of these strategies for school, but more specifically I'm using this for witchcraft and all the sort of areas of study that go with it, because it's for studying things that you enjoy. Now, number one, I think that a lot of us struggle with the concept of studying for fun, because for the most part, for most of our lives, we associate studying with things that we have to learn, you know, for school and for grades, and so it's not always necessarily like a fun thing. Most subjects we're not really going to enjoy enough to really say that we like studying it, and that sort of puts a weird thing, that puts a weird headspace on us as it relates to studying in general, and so it becomes hard to sort of figure out how to study things that you actually want to learn. And most of us do it in a really organic way, but I think the academic approach is something that has always worked better for me. But studying at home is kind of hard, even for things that I like. So I have developed over time a system that works for me when it comes to specifically studying witchcraft. Now, number one, I think a really, really important thing to remember is don't beat yourself up. You're not taking any tests. There's nothing that's gonna grade you on this. There's no, like, if you don't get it right, you'll fail the course kind of pressure. It's for your enjoyment and your learning. There's no timeline on it. There's no deadline of you have to learn all of the cards of the tarot by this date, or you have to learn all of the planets and the signs and the houses by this date. There's no timeline. So you can take the studying process as slow as you want, which I think is great. But, you know, a lot of people stress out about needing to get it all right, and it doesn't all have to be right today. You can take your time. So just relax and you know, chill with it, because you don't have to beat yourself up if you don't get it right on the first go around. So for the actual like study process, that tends to be a little bit more like preparatory steps in order to sort of get myself in the right headspace for it. So number one, I would say get dressed. And this might sound a little bit silly, but especially during quarantine or anybody who works from home, getting dressed is always going to be really, really important, because we need to be in the like doing daily tasks mode, and if you're just still in the pajamas you slept in or just slouchy clothes, it's gonna be a lot harder to sort of be in the study mood. So at the very least, I always try to throw on some jeans or just something that's not my pajamas, and I try to make sure that I'm actually like dressed. I've brushed my teeth, I've done my hair, today I showered and washed my face, and so I really just got ready for the day, and then I'm ready to jump into studying. And step two is a little bit harder, but it's more of you need to learn what works for you, because the right study method for one person isn't going to be the right study method for another. So try to remember from school what stuff worked for you. Try to figure out what environments work for you. Some people like music, some people like silence, some people like some white noise. Get your lighting right, get some snacks. There's sort of like a setting up the environment for yourself that I think is really important. Now for me, I like to light a candle. Yeah, you can see it in the background there. I like to have a candle burning for some nice scents. Sometimes I'll light some incense, and if you have some that are your favorites or that correspond to whatever you're trying to learn, that can be a great way to incorporate the witchy stuff into it. And then for snacks, I need a little bit of fuel to keep me going. And you know, we can also stir your intention into it, do a sigil with honey if you're drinking some tea, you know, add some witchy things there. But really, like, setting the mood is something that is important for me. And something that I really like to do is the sound of fireplace noises. I think it's something about like the lower bassy tone of like the roaring fire, but I literally have this 12-hour loop of fireplace sounds, I'll link it in the description, that I like to use, and it's literally all I put on. I sometimes will do lo-fi, but honestly, music in general can get a little distracting, especially if I know the song already. So I try to avoid music, but there are some days where it works. So especially things that don't have a lot of words or any words at all, like just instrumental stuff, that is proven to help with studying. And you know, you can make it sort of witchy moods, you can get like Celtic soundtracks. I like the fire because that also makes me feel a little bit witchy. You can get like a sort of I don't know what they're called, soundscapes? They're something like that. But like, they'll have a pretty picture of the environment. You could like make that full screen and you could have, you know, one of those like the Harry Potter dorm study place, and you've got like the fire and the candles everywhere, so you could sort of like make a visual background for yourself at your computer. And I just like the right sounds to be with it because it helps keep me from getting distracted. Now the other thing is, you don't have to be rigid with how long you're studying for. There are some days where I'll study for 3 hours straight, and sometimes it'll be like 15 minutes and then a 20 minute break, and then 5 minutes and then a half an hour break, and then 30 minutes and a 5 minute break. It'll get really mixed around a lot, and that's the nice thing about studying for yourself is because there's no time limit, it's not like you have to make sure you get through 3 chapters tonight or else you'll fail your test tomorrow. Like, there's no worry about that. So you can really just sort of be loose with it, and that sort of loops back to the don't beat yourself up. Don't get upset if you end up taking a lot of breaks, because you can. You're allowed to. I'll take a break to like make dinner, and I'll go to the bathroom, and maybe I'll check social media or whatever. I'll talk to people on Discord, and then I'll come back to it for half an hour. Or I'll do like 10 minutes and then 5 minutes and then 10 minutes and then 5 minutes, sort of back and forth. Another thing that works for a lot of people is the Pomodoro method. I'll link to it below. It's like this specific setup of like long study, short break, long study, short break, long study, short break, short study, long break. It breaks it up into like chunks that helps your brain work really well. Supposedly there's like science behind it, I don't know. But that tends to work for a lot of people. There's lots of timers out there that they'll, you know, gently tell you, hey, it's time for your break, or it's time to come out of your break. So if that method works for you, I'll have that linked below for people. Now, the actual note-taking process. This is where personal style will sort of come into it, but I have some general recommendations that I think will work for pretty much most people. At least it's what I like to do. Leave the pretty journals for later. So a while ago in my dollar store affordable witchy haul, I mentioned that at the dollar store I just picked up a literal dollar notebook and these folders, and that's what I use for my notes. I mean, honestly, right now I'm taking some notes on astrology, some of the more complicated bits, or things that are new to me in terms of ancient astrology, and I'm just taking the notes on this notebook paper, and then I have my folders, and inside is my notes. Like, I literally just write them on notebook paper and put them in these folders, and that's my process for like what I do with my notes. I leave the like pretty Book of Shadows pages for another time, because it's not really important to make it pretty, it's important to learn it. So step one for me is always gonna be notebook paper. When I'm taking notes, I try to make sure that I know what I'm sourcing from. So I'll have, you know, I try not to mix it on one page too much, but if I do, I'll just note where it changes from one source to another. But I'll note at the top of the page, all of this is from such and such book. If it's for astrology, it's Chris Brennan's Hellenistic Astrology book. You know, if it's tarot, well, I'll list some of the tarot books that I'm going through. But I try to list the source so that if I ever need to reference that book again, or if I was sort of unclear in my notes, I can go back and find it in that book. Because if I didn't, I wouldn't know where I got the information from, and I wouldn't be able to see like, okay, this book says this thing and this book says this thing easily on my notes. So write down where your sources are from just for your own reference. Next is, do handwritten notes first if you're able. Now for some people it's a little bit harder, you know, if you struggle with physical writing, if your handwriting is just really garbage and hard to read, if you have any other reasons that, you know, physical writing is gonna be difficult, you can skip over this, it's fine, it's just what I like to do. As many times as you can sort of record it, the better, but I also end up being a lot messier with my physical notes. When I'm doing it, it's just sort of free form, loose all over the paper, and I end up transferring it later, and in that transferring process I can sort of edit it and clean it up and move things around. If it's like, you know, this section covers this and then it revisits it here, but now I have 3 paragraphs of notes in between, I can clean that up when I move it to digital later. And then, you know, move everything to digital. So you take in your handwritten notes. I like to transfer to digital because I like to add diagrams, I like to be able to clean it up, and most importantly, you get to Control F or Command F if you're on Mac. You can search through your notes. So if you're doing tarot and you want to quickly find the Nine of Wands, you can just search Control F, Nine of Wands, or just Wands in general. You can find those sections, it'll bring everything up for you, and so it's really easy to find it in your notes rather than having to like shuffle through all of your papers and try to find exactly where this one note was. You can search by keywords. Like, being able to search is really, really, really helpful. So I definitely recommend physical and then digital, especially because you can then go online and find pictures related to whatever you're studying. I do this a lot with herbs, where I'll go online and find like a picture of the plant, I'll get detail photos, and I'll put all of those in with my notes about the plant, on top of like where I might find it, if it's in my neighborhood and it's something I found, I could take pictures of my own and then insert them. And that tends to be a little bit harder on physical notebook paper unless you have like a photo printer, but not everyone's gonna have those. So digital is definitely the way for that. And then after that, once you have all of your notes compiled digitally, that's when I would say you could put it into like a nice pretty book of shadows. I don't worry about that pretty stuff until way down the line. I really take a while until I put it into my book of shadows, but the actual getting to the notes process is the really hard part for a lot of people, because you end up with this sort of notebook paralysis where your book of shadows is so pretty and nice, and what if your information is gonna change later? It's really why I push digital for a lot of people, because super easy to change and you don't have to worry about materials. You know, you're not gonna run out of pages. It's always gonna be as long as you need it to be. The other thing is gonna be stylizing your stuff. I really have a specific style that I go with when it comes to my digital notes. I like certain colors, certain fonts. I have like headings and certain ways that I mark up the text on top of like the pictures that I'll add in. And it allows me to use like text symbols. If you really want, you could use emojis. Like, if that's a style of note taking that works for you, you can do that. But being able to add in colors and fonts really helps me to not only break up the space, but also sort of figure out where one section starts and ends. And so if I'm doing like planets and then signs, I can very easily see, without having to look at any of the words at all, just by I see a new header, I know a new section has started. So I can sort of filter through and be like, all right, there's the planet section. I'll just find the next header and move along. And by color coding and using symbols, you can also help yourself to be able to distinguish. So if you wanted to have like plants in your neighborhood versus plants that you're just researching in general, you can color code those differently. You could have, if you're researching stones, you could have each like stone labeled by color. If you're doing tarot, you could have each of the suits in different colors as you're organizing it on your document. So it's really, really easy to see each of the different sections by color coding, and it makes it a little bit more fun. So, you know, as much fun as you can inject into the note taking, the better. I find a lot of people don't actually know how to study well. I'm one of those people. It's really hard because it's not really a skill that many people will teach you. You kind of just learn it yourself, and if you don't like learn the proper way to study, it ends up being very difficult to come back to it later. And that's one of the nice things about there being no time pressure, is you can sort of play with study styles. But what I really like to do is flashcards. Flashcards are really useful because it allows you to like challenge yourself. And a lot of things online, you can start with either side. So you could start with like the definition or the symbol or the picture or whatever. And you know, either one that you want to start with, you could sort of check your work that way. I think flashcards are really brilliant. I've talked before about I use my actual tarot cards as flashcards themselves. So I'll just go through the deck and like pick up a card and I'll make sure that I know what it means, or at least I was doing that when I was studying them originally. And there's actually a couple of websites online that you can find. There's one called Study Blue that my Spanish teacher in high school introduced me to, and I actually really like it. I'll link that below. There's lots of stuff. If you look for flashcards, you know, flashcard makers online, you can find them. You can make physical flashcards, but it's money. So digital's free, and I always advocate for free or cheap. Another study method that some people do is just rereading their notes. If you take good enough notes, just going back over them can be enough to study from. I end up missing things here and there, so rereading my notes alone isn't always the best method. I sometimes have to like go back to the book, which is great if I've written down the source, so I can go back to the source and find this area that I'm trying to study from, and I can look over that and see what's missing from my notes and maybe re-add to them. Part of the study process is that when you're transferring from your handwritten notes, which is your first take, to your digital notes, the more times you sort of have to like get it down, the more it locks into your brain, which is really helpful. And one of the final study methods, which can be kind of the scariest, is actually to try to teach somebody else. Now, this might seem counterintuitive because you're like, well, wait, I'm trying to learn it. Why would I ever think that I could teach someone else? I would say find a friend that knows this is what you're doing and that you might get some of it wrong, especially if they happen to know the subject already, but they don't have to. Just try to teach it to them and you can sort of test yourself and see how much you've actually synthesized, how much you've actually sort of gotten down, how many pieces you might still be missing. I know that when I'm trying to do stuff for other people, it often becomes very apparent of, oh yeah, this is an area I thought I knew, but I'm definitely still lacking in that. So that lets me know I have to go back and study that area. So if I'm, so let's say I'm doing an astrological reading for somebody. If I get like the planets and the signs and the houses all down, but I can't remember the aspect patterns really well and I can't remember what they mean, I can tell myself, I have to go back and relearn the aspects, and I sort of have to, you know, work harder on that section. Trying to teach somebody else is a great way to test yourself. And you might actually be surprised at what you do know. You might be doubting yourself and thinking, I don't know enough, I don't really have any idea what I'm doing, I don't know any of this. But when you're trying to teach somebody else, you go, oh man, maybe I do know more than I thought I did. So teaching somebody else, brilliant tool. And of course, as you're teaching somebody else, don't be afraid to look over your notes. This is an open book test, you know, if you need to have your notes out beside you while you're doing stuff like that. A lot of people will just straight up have their books on the subject with them when they're doing whatever thing. I know a lot of people who do tarot will have their books about tarot handy, because there's always one or two that trip everybody up, or you need to reference it, or you think you remember something, but you want to look it up again anyway. So a lot of people will just have their books on hand, and they'll open them up and look through it and find that one thing that they were missing or had forgotten. It's no shame in having to go back to your notes. Especially with this being a lifelong path, taking your time is going to be really important, and not pressuring yourself to get it all right on the first try is really important. I think that we sort of get stuck in this mentality of there's a test tomorrow and I need to learn it all day, but we don't. You can take 10 years to learn this thing that you're trying to learn. You could take a month. I mean, it's as long or as short as you want it to be, but there is no pressure. There's no time limit. So just, you know, take it slow. All right, so it was a, you know, more of an academic style thing, but I think it's really important, because when it comes to witchcraft, we often don't remember that studying can be for fun. So I hope that you guys are able to use some of these study methods for yourselves and apply them. If you wanted to talk about some of your study methods, if you wanted to talk about the things that you're learning, I have a Discord server. So if you guys wanted to come along and join me in my community there, we talk all the time, all day, every day about all sorts of stuff. So I would love to hear what you're studying currently, what you're doing, what you're up to. Otherwise, all of my social media links will be down below. And if you want to support me monetarily, I have a Patreon, I have a couple goodies, and you always get videos early. So if you would like to support me financially, you can sign up for my Patreon. Otherwise, I'll see you guys next time, and blessed be. Good luck studying.